Recorded Books presents an unabridged recording of Iroquois Diplomacy on the Early American Frontier by Timothy J. Shannon, narrated by George K. Wilson, and directed by Jenny Seelig. This book is copyrighted 2008 by Timothy J. Shannon. This recording is copyrighted 2008 by Recorded Books. The Iroquois were the most influential Native American confederacy of early America. They occupied a strategic region between Canada and New York and engaged in active trade and diplomacy with their Dutch, French, and British neighbors. Contradicting the notion of the noble savage, Timothy J. Shannon portrays a politically savvy and at times treacherous Iroquois nation as it coped with the encroaching tide of colonialism. And now, Iroquois Diplomacy on the Early American Frontier.
Prologue. Four Kings and a Queen. In the spring of 1710, four Indians from the Mohawk Valley arrived in London for an audience with Queen Anne. Colonel Francis Nicholson and Colonel Peter Schuyler, the colonial administrators who sponsored this trip, hoped to impress their Indian guests with the riches of Britain's capital city. Having weathered the upheavals of civil war, plague, and fire during the 17th century, London in 1710 was well prepared for the visit. The great symbol of the city's rebirth, St. Paul's Cathedral, towered over the skyline, while smaller churches also designed by Sir Christopher Wren anchored neighborhoods rebuilt in a neoclassical style to evoke the glories of ancient Rome. Everywhere one looked, the streets were crowded with people buying and selling goods from all over the world, while in counting houses and coffee houses, bankers and merchants cut the deals that made them rich. What Indian from the backwaters of New York, a colony that was itself on the fringe of the civilized world, could help but be impressed by the sights, sounds, and smells of a city on the cusp of world power? A funny thing happened on the way to see the Queen. The four Indian kings, as the local press called them, became celebrities. Londoners, not the Indians, were the smitten ones. In addition to being wined and dined by leading officials of church and state, the Indian kings toured London sights, drawing admiring crowds wherever they went. The Tower of London, St. Paul's, theaters, and cockfights. Like other foreign dignitaries, they observed the lunatics confined at Bethlehem, Bedlam Hospital, and offered alms to the poor at the city's workhouses. Theater owners published advance notices of the Indian king's attendance at their shows, hoping their popularity would boost their crowds. On one such occasion, unruly spectators in the gallery refused to let a performance of Macbeth proceed until they had a better view of the four Indian kings seated in a front box. Actors calmed the crowd by placing chairs on the stage and having the guests of honor move there. Londoners with a few pence to spare could purchase ballads, chapbooks, and engravings in the city's print shops and bookstalls detailing the Indian king's adventures. Three artists painted their portraits, one working at the behest of the queen. By any measure, plebeian or patrician, the four Indian kings had taken London by storm. We know very little about the personal backgrounds of the four Indian kings. Their sponsors, Nicholson and Schuyler, were colonial military adventurers trying to launch an expedition against French Canada. In New York, one of their chief concerns was recruiting warriors from the five Iroquois nations to assist them. The Iroquois, from east to west, the Mohawks, Oneidas, Onondagas, Cayugas, and Senecas, controlled the territory between Albany and Canada, and Nicholson and Schuyler could not expect to move an army through there without Iroquois cooperation. Plans for such an expedition had fizzled a year earlier because naval support promised by the Queen's ministers had failed to materialize. Ever resourceful, Nicholson and Schuyler believed that a carefully planned visit to the royal court by a party of allied Iroquois just might convince the Queen to endorse another expedition planned for the 1711 campaign season, while also impressing the Iroquois with Britain's military power and wealth. Nicholson and Schuyler had initially planned to recruit one chief from each of the five Iroquois nations for their mission. Instead, they ended up with a much less representative sample. Three were Mohawks, the Iroquois nation closest to Albany, and the one most closely allied with the British. Teeninhogaro, also known by his Christian name Hendrick, was styled by Nicholson and Schuyler as the Emperor of the Six Nations. Sogayianquarato, also known as Brant, was identified as King of the Maquas, Mohawks. Oneyeath To No Rio, also known as John, was identified as King of Ganajohore, Canajohari, a Mohawk town. The fourth Indian king was not even an Iroquois. Ito O'Kaum, also known as Nicholas, and identified by Nicholson and Schuyler as the King of the River Indians, came from a community of Indians who lived in the northern Hudson Valley. Of the four, we know the most about Hendrick. He was about 50 years old in 1710, and an influential figure among the Protestant Mohawks who lived near Albany. Brant and John were also Christians, but they didn't appear to have any particular political authority or influence among their people. Nicholas was a war chief among the River Indians, who were mostly Mohicans pushed east of the Hudson by the Mohawks in the 17th century. His Christian name indicates religious conversion, but the lack of any documentation to this effect in local sources suggests that Nicholson and Schuyler may have arranged his conversion as last-minute window dressing for his audience with the Queen. Hendrick's grand title, Emperor of the Six Nations, rings a bit hollow for a fellow who had no apparent reputation beyond the lower Mohawk Valley. The Six, presumably, refers to the five Iroquois nations plus the River Indians represented by Nicholas. Likewise, the claim of the other three to the title of king appears to have begun and ended with the publicity accorded to them by Nicholson and Schuyler. Whatever power these four individuals may have held over Iroquois, other than their immediate neighbors, remains unclear. All that we can say definitively about them is that they were four British allied Indians with at least nominal Christian identities. One observer in New York stated bluntly that Hendrick could not command 10 men, and that the other three were no sachems. Had Nicholson and Schuyler been more practiced in honesty than spin, they might have billed their Indian travelers as one local chief and his improvised entourage. There are many ways to interpret the visit of the four Indian kings to London. Anyone familiar with the habit Europeans made of turning pliable Indians into chiefs so that they could sign away land in fraudulent treaties might view this episode as tragedy, just another chapter in a centuries-long swindle of continental dimensions. It is worth noting, however, that the four Indian kings did not sign a treaty or sell any land while in London. Others might be inclined to describe the four Indian kings' trip as comedy, a reality show reversal of Shakespeare's The Tempest, in which Indians, rather than Europeans, found themselves shipwrecked in a strange magical place inhabited by inscrutable natives. London satirists saw it as such and used the occasion to pen critiques of English manners and customs by assuming the perspective of these beleaguered and bemused foreign visitors. At least one contemporary writer preferred the conventions of romance. He composed a ballad in which one of the Indian kings fell in love with an English maiden he met in St. James's Park. Literary representations aside, the four Indian kings' visit to London was first and foremost an exercise in diplomacy. Hendrick and his compatriots were received in the royal court as foreign heads of state, and they had meetings with such prominent officials as the Captain General of the British Army, the Lords Commissioners of the Admiralty, the Board of Trade, an advisory body on colonial administration, and the Bishop of London. Observers describe the Indian king's conduct and appearance in these encounters with the same deferential superlatives typically bestowed on foreign nobility, praising their graceful carriage, quiet gravitas, and generosity toward the poor. What purpose, then, did this embassy have? The motives of its chief orchestrators, Nicholson and Schuyler, were clear enough. They wanted the Indian kings and queen to impress each other so that each side would be more willing to support their scheme for conquering Canada. One has to admire their gumption, for their plan could have backfired in all sorts of ways. What if the queen had refused an audience with these uninvited visitors? What if the Indians had proven to be less than majestic in their comportment? What if a skeptical minister in the Queen's court had asked the Indians to present their credentials, as any other foreign diplomat was expected to do? In any such instance, the four kings held by Nicholson and Schuyler might have been easily exposed as a bluff. Determining what the four Indians wanted to get out of this embassy is much harder to do. Were they dupes or partners in Nicholson's and Schuyler's poker game? The Indian kings left no record of their own purposes or impressions from their trip. One died shortly after returning to America, and two slipped quietly back into anonymity. Only Hendrick remained a significant figure in New York's Indian affairs, but if he ever offered a commentary on his experiences in London, it has not survived. The only portal we have into the Indians' perspective on their trip is the speech they delivered to Queen Anne at St. James Palace. Even this source is problematic. It was read by Major David Pigeon, an aide to Nicholson and Schuyler, while the Indians stood by in silent testimony. None of them spoke English. Abraham Schuyler, cousin to Peter, acted as their interpreter. The speech was short, and much of it reflected Nicholson's and Peter Schuyler's agenda, asking for the Queen's help in making war against her enemies, the French. Some elements of the speech, however, suggest the Indians' input. The Iroquoian metaphors of taking up the hatchet and hanging up the kettle are used to describe preparing for war, and at the end of the speech, the Indians presented the Queen with belts of wampum, the traditional device used by the Iroquois to punctuate diplomatic speeches. Most significantly, the Indian kings requested that the Queen send a missionary to live among them, lest their people be seduced by French priests into leaving their homes to live among other Iroquois who had converted to Catholicism and resettled in Canada. This request for a missionary would certainly have received Nicholson's and Schuyler's approval, but it is also reasonable to assume that the four Indian kings considered this the primary objective of their embassy. In the late 17th century, French Jesuits had converted a considerable number of Mohawks and moved them to communities around Montreal. This outmigration of kin and neighbors threatened the security and stability of those Mohawks who remained in their homelands. A Protestant missionary, sponsored by the Queen herself, would be a powerful agent on their behalf, someone with the material resources and spiritual commitment necessary to counter the lure of the Jesuits and to help those Indians who remained in the Mohawk Valley. Queen Anne took their wishes seriously. She referred them to the Society for the Propagation of the Gospel, SPG, the missionary arm of the Anglican Church, which appropriated funding to pay for two missionaries and chapels among the Iroquois. The SPG also presented each king with a Bible and a copy of the Book of Common Prayer. Queen Anne chipped in with two sets of silver communion plates. These handsome gifts marked the start of a relationship between the Mohawks and the SPG that would continue for several generations. In the years ahead, Anglican missionaries would assist the Mohawks in their material needs during times of want and serve as important intermediaries between them and the Crown's American officials. At the conclusion of the Indian King's royal audience, Queen Anne also ordered that £200 be spent on presents for them. When the Indians departed for home several weeks later, this generous grant had been converted into goods Indians typically acquired from the North American fur trade. Bolts of cloth, gunpowder and lead for ammunition, knives and kettles, scissors, razors, combs, mirrors, necklaces, and other jewelry and novelties. Each king also received a personal present that included a hat, trunk, gun, sword, pistols, and a variety of other incidentals, including a picture of the queen, no mention made of autographs, and a magic lantern with pictures. Magic lantern? This item was a plaything of the wealthy in the early 18th century, a sort of primordial television that projected images from hand-painted glass plates onto a wall or screen. We don't know whether the Indian kings ever made use of their magic lanterns for this purpose, but they were a fitting souvenir of their trip, which had been an exercise in the manipulation of appearances from start to finish. Four anonymous Indians had crossed the ocean to be feted as kings before the queen and her subjects. They came with only the clothes on their backs, but left like movie stars on Oscars night, lugging gift bags overstuffed with swag. Nicholson and Schuyler may have been engaged in an elaborate bluff, but the four Indian kings played the winning hand. Iroquois peoples can be found today on réserve in the provinces of Quebec and Ontario in Canada, and on reservations in New York, Wisconsin, and Oklahoma in the United States. Many other Iroquois choose to live and work among non-Indians in the cities, suburbs, and rural towns of North America. In this respect, 21st century Iroquois are no different from other modern Native Americans whose lives reflect the cultural, political, and economic legacies of 500 years of exchange and conflict with Europeans. Some Iroquois today practice the Catholic or Protestant faiths their ancestors first encountered in the colonial era, while others follow the spiritual beliefs and traditions of their non-Christian ancestors. Some speak a native tongue as their first or second language, while others know only English or French. Centuries of political and military conflict have led to the dispersal and displacement of many Iroquois from their ancestors' homelands, but they have maintained their cultural identity despite the best efforts of governments, churches, and schools run by non-Indians to eradicate it. Like other Native Americans, modern Iroquois peoples live with one foot firmly in the past, committed to preserving their unique culture and history, and the other in the present, doing the best they can to make their way in a world that has often insisted that they cease being Indian if they want to survive. Despite their continued vitality in the modern world, mention of the Iroquois among non-Indians today will most likely call to mind the image of a fierce warrior from the colonial era. The usual story goes something like this. When confronted by grasping colonizers and meddling missionaries, the Iroquois fought back. Other Indians may have made peace with the invaders, selling their land for beads and broken promises, sending their children off to missionary schools run by their new overlords, but the Iroquois stood firm. They had conquered an empire of their own in wars with other northeastern Indians, and as long as they remained united, they kept their French and British rivals at bay. Internal divisions finally divided the Iroquois League during the Revolutionary War, enabling the Continental Army to invade their homelands and disperse the fractured remnants of their once mighty Confederacy to reservations in New York and Canada. This image of the Iroquois has a very distinguished lineage. Its roots can be traced to impressions of the Iroquois recorded by French missionaries and British colonial officials during the colonial era. In the 19th century, writers and scholars such as Francis Parkman, James Fenimore Cooper, and Lewis Henry Morgan assigned the Iroquois a central role in American history and literature, and depicted them as first-rate statesmen as well as warriors. Other Indians may have fought bravely against the European invaders, but only the Iroquois created a confederacy that was capable of withstanding the juggernaut of colonization for so long. That it was a doomed effort made it no less noble. 19th century Americans never doubted that divine providence had ordained the conquest and subjugation of the continent's indigenous peoples, but they saw in the Iroquois a political genius that was uniquely American. This powerful Indian confederacy met defeat only when it was confronted by another homegrown American union, one made up of liberty-loving colonists intent on throwing off the yoke of British monarchy. The United States was the phoenix that arose out of the destruction of the Iroquois, another fruit born of the American wilderness, arrayed in all the blessings of Christian civilization, but without the old world's corruption or inequality. The misguided notion that the Iroquois somehow served as midwives to the birth of the United States has come into full flower within the last generation or so. In 1987, the United States Senate passed a resolution acknowledging the contribution of the Iroquois Confederacy of Nations to the development of the United States Constitution. In this same spirit of recognition, some writers have described the Iroquois as forgotten founders, whose indigenous forms of government provided a model for democracy and federal union from which the more famous founding fathers, especially Benjamin Franklin and Thomas Jefferson, borrowed freely. In this story, the Iroquois warrior puts down his hatchet and picks up his wampum belt so that he can pass along ancient native wisdom on freedom and liberty to the new nation. It is not easy to fit the four Indian kings who visited Queen Anne in 1710 into either of these commonly held perceptions of the Iroquois. The four kings did not arrive in London as warriors painted for the warpath. They did not throw the scalps of their enemies at the Queen's feet, nor did they offer any tutorials to the Queen and her ministers on how to set up a confederation of self-governing republics in America, where all could live in liberty and equality. Rather, their English counterparts called them kings, and they were happy to be treated as such. Diplomacy, unlike warfare, is about getting something you want from someone else by convincing them that they are benefiting from the bargain. The four Indian kings went to London to see what the Queen might be able to do for them in exchange for what they might offer her. This negotiation followed its own intercultural logic. It was draped in the ceremony of the royal court, but it also involved Native American customs, such as the exchange of wampum and gift-giving. All participants spoke in high-minded language about friendship and alliance, but an air of deception and manipulation hung about the proceedings. Each side was willing to pretend to be something it was not in order to advance its ends. Queen Anne and her ministers pretended to be interested in the fate of a distant colony few of them could have placed on a map. The four kings pretended to be loving and dedicated allies, and Nicholson and Schuyler pretended to each side that they could command the resources necessary to conquer Canada. It was all a bit suspect, but only if our perception of Indians is limited to stereotypes of bloodthirsty warriors and grandfatherly wise men. The 18th-century Iroquois were neither mercenary killing machines nor idealistic forest-dwelling Democrats. They were flesh-and-blood participants in a scramble for dominion in North America, and diplomacy was their tool of choice. Their negotiations with Indian and European counterparts involved occasional subterfuge, obfuscation, and exaggeration of the sort witnessed in London in 1710. But negotiation on the colonial frontier also demanded flexibility and innovation, the ability to create and maintain peace with others who rarely shared your interests or perspectives. This is the story of the Iroquois in early America that deserves to be told. Chapter 1. Peace in the Balance. In July 1743, four visitors arrived to a fine welcome at the town of Onondaga, the geographic and ceremonial center of the Iroquois League. Their arrival was expected, for the travelers had sent messengers ahead as they traveled northward through the Susquehanna Valley. At each Indian town along the route, residents came out to greet them, old and young, men and women, singing songs, beating drums, and offering lodgings and meals. Children climbed onto rooftops to get a better look at them. All this fanfare culminated with their arrival at Onondaga, where the local chiefs greeted the travelers with a grave, cheerful complaisance, according to their custom, provided them with comfortable lodgings and an ample meal, and then shared a pipe of good tobacco with them. The chiefs already knew two of the visitors. Conrad Visor was a colonial Indian agent who had lived among the Mohawks as a child before moving to southern Pennsylvania. On this trip, he was working for the governor of Virginia, who wanted to restore peace after some Iroquois and settlers had clashed on the frontier of his colony. Visor was accompanied by Shikellamy, an Oneida chief who lived in the Susquehanna Valley and knew the route between Pennsylvania and Onondaga well. The other two members of the party were strangers. John Bartram was a Philadelphia botanist, and Lewis Evans, a Welsh cartographer who had recently immigrated to America. Both men had come along at Visor's invitation so that they could get a better look at the country of the Iroquois. Bartram recorded in his journal the many new experiences he had on this trip. He described the food he ate, the houses he slept in, and the strange sights and sounds that surrounded him. All the smoking, drinking, and dining gave him a quick intimacy with his hosts, but he still encountered customs and behavior that he could not begin to comprehend. Luckily, Visor and Shikellamy were there to assist him. After bedding down for their first night in Onondaga, the visitors were awakened by a masked Indian dancer who shook a rattle and made a hideous noise. A panicked Bartram called out to Visor for an explanation, but his answer came from Shikellamy, who told him to lie still, John. This reply left Bartram even more startled, for although he had already spent plenty of time on the road with Shikellamy, he had never heard him speak so much plain English before. What else was his Indian companion not telling him? Over the next several days, Bartram and Evans pursued their scientific interests, while Visor and Shikellamy attended to their own business. The chiefs dispatched messengers, and gradually representatives from other nations in the Confederacy trickled into Onondaga. Visor spent several days in private meetings with chiefs he already knew well, hoping they would smooth his way once their formal council began. Visor was an old hand at conducting such diplomacy, but he still felt it necessary to enlist Indian partners who could tell him how to speak to everything when the council should be met. Each passing day brought more smoking, eating, and drinking, until finally, 10 days after Visor's arrival, the chiefs said they were ready to hear him. He made his speech on behalf of the Virginians, offering to renew peace and promising a substantial present of trade goods. At key points, Visor punctuated his speech by passing across the council fire strings and belts of wampum, beads manufactured from marine shells. The chiefs responded in kind and professed their renewed friendship for the Virginians. Visor's embassy wrapped up, according to the ancient custom of his hosts, with a song of friendship and joy, sung by the chiefs and well-wishing for their guests. Visor and his companions left town with their missions accomplished, their bellies full, and their horses weighed down with provisions for the road homeward. The journals of Visor and Bartram from this trip are filled with valuable eyewitness accounts of Iroquois politics and culture, but like so many sources used by historians, they also raise more questions than they answer. Encountering the Iroquois for the first time, Bartram filled his pages with wonderful anecdotes about their hospitality, work routines, and ceremonies, but he made no attempt to describe their culture in a systematic way. Visor, the seasoned Indian agent, provided a detailed record of his private and public negotiations, but he felt no need to elaborate on matters already familiar to him, such as how the Iroquois built their homes, wore their clothes, or made their livings. Neither of these observers tackled the big questions that historians ask about the Iroquois. How did their confederacy originate? What purposes did it serve? And how did they keep it together? To answer these questions, we must rely on a variety of evidence, much of it as fragmentary and impressionistic as the journals left by Bartram and Visor. Other colonial Europeans, travelers, traders, missionaries, captives, left written descriptions of the Iroquois, each with its own distinctive perspective and bias. Archaeological evidence offers clues about Iroquois life before and after European contact, but material objects cannot reconstruct a culture in its entirety. Oral traditions open another perspective on Iroquois history, revealing how the Iroquois explained their place within the natural and spiritual worlds. The work of anthropologists and linguists, who began studying the Iroquois in earnest in the mid-19th century, provides yet another vantage point. but such information reflects Iroquois life and culture at the time it was collected and cannot be relied on to reveal what came before it. In short, all of these sources are valuable, but imperfect. They cannot answer all of our questions definitively. To a certain degree, we are like Bartram during that first night in Onondaga, calling out in the darkness for an explanation of something we barely comprehend. The Turtle's Back. At the time of their contact with Europeans, the Iroquois inhabited a region south of Lake Ontario that stretched across modern upstate New York from Albany to Buffalo. From east to west, the Mohawks, Oneidas, Onondagas, Cayugas, and Senecas recognized a cultural kinship with each other and maintained peace amongst themselves. They spoke different but related languages, all derived from what linguists call the Iroquoian stock. There were other Iroquoian-speaking peoples in eastern North America, but that linguistic similarity did not make them a part of the distinctive political union that encompassed these five groups, and eventually a sixth, the Tuscaroras, who migrated from North Carolina into Iroquois in the early 18th century. Iroquois was a region of rich and diverse resources. Major waterways connected it to the eastern seaboard as well as the continent's interior. The Mohawk River flowed eastward to the Hudson, a river that, along with Lake Champlain, formed a wide north-to-south corridor between modern Montreal and New York City. In the west, the Allegheny River flowed out of Seneca country toward modern Pittsburgh, where it joined with the Monongahela to form the Ohio, the Mississippi's major eastern tributary. Lakes Erie and Ontario provided the Iroquois with access to the vast northern waterways of the Great Lakes, and the Susquehanna River flowed out of southern Iroquois into Chesapeake Bay. Winter acts like a bad guest in this region, arriving early and staying late. But the temperate summers make for bountiful growing seasons. The surrounding woodlands provided fuel for heating and cooking, as well as plenty of animals to hunt for meat and pelts. Fishing and seasonal gathering of fruit, nuts, roots, and sap from maple trees rounded out a diverse and healthy diet. Based on the analysis of pottery and other man-made objects, archaeologists believe that the Iroquois emerged from the Owasco people, a cultural group that inhabited the region south of Lake Ontario from approximately AD 900 to AD 1350. The formation of a distinctive Iroquois culture was a gradual process that occurred as successive generations adapted to their environment, asserted control over their borders, and developed a common identity. That identity included a shared sense of the past, and the Iroquois told a creation story to explain where they came from. According to it, the world began in this manner. When the earth was only a limitless sea, there lived in the sky world a pregnant woman who craved odd things to eat. She sent her husband out one day to find her new delicacies by digging about the roots of the great tree, the sacred center of the sky world. The husband's digging opened up a hole in the floor of the sky world, exposing another world below of limitless sea and sky. Fearful, he backed away, but his curious wife moved closer for a better look, until she slipped into the hole. In some versions of the story, her husband pushes her. Grasping at the roots of the great tree for a hold, she fell into the world below. The birds of the sky saw her coming. They rescued her by flying together and forming a net to break her fall. One of their number flew down to the creatures of the sea to ask for their help, and a turtle allowed her to land on his back. A muskrat brought a bit of dirt up from the ocean floor, which the woman augmented with the bits of earth and roots she had grabbed from the great tree as she fell. From this meager beginning, the earth formed, and plants grew to sustain the woman. She gave birth to a daughter, who assisted her in tending this earth until she herself became pregnant with twins. While still in the womb, the twins fought. The right-handed twin was born normally, but the left-handed twin moved upward rather than downward in his mother's body, coming out of her armpit and killing her in the process. The twins buried her body, and from her head grew corn, beans, and squash, the three sisters of Iroquois horticulture. From her heart grew tobacco, used in Iroquois healing and sacred ceremonies. The twins shared in their mother's and grandmother's generative powers, but they also checked each other's efforts in a constant contest for dominance. The right-handed twin made deer and squirrels, but the left-handed twin made mountain lions and weasels. Likewise, the right-handed twin's fruit trees and berries were countered by the left-handed twin's briars and poison ivy. The rivers that the right-handed twin made straight and free of obstacles were turned crooked and full of rapids by his brother. The twins also made humans, forming them out of clay and baking them in a fire like pottery. Through their many battles, the twins remained evenly matched, until one day, the right-handed brother finally triumphed and killed the left-handed one. His act of fratricide angered his grandmother, the Sky Woman, and he killed her as well, throwing her head into the sky, where it became the moon. He then went to live in the sky world as the master of life, where he continues to watch over the humans he created and to enjoy the scent of the tobacco they burn in his honor. His brother, who some call Flint, also remains attentive to human affairs. He rules the realm of night, and warfare and human suffering please him. Elements of this story resonate throughout Iroquois culture. The primary roles of Sky Woman and her daughter in the Earth's creation reflect the considerable authority and respect women commanded in Iroquois society as the heads of families and the growers of the crops that were the mainstays of the Iroquois diet. This creation story is also indicative of Iroquois perceptions of human-animal relations. Several creatures played important roles in saving Sky Woman after her fall, and while the right-handed and left-handed twins created animals, they did not give humans lordship over them. On the contrary, humans were only one piece in this creation, not its crowning achievement. Even the story's parallels to the Book of Genesis, the tree, the fallen woman, the sons who personify good and evil, suggest how contact with colonial missionaries may have affected the Iroquoian worldview. The story of Sky Woman also holds important insights for understanding the origins and purposes of Iroquois diplomacy. The most significant elements in this regard are its themes of balance and reciprocity. In the biblical version of creation, the absence of evil from the world before Eve's sin makes it a perfect place. It is only after Eve has eaten the forbidden fruit that this paradise is irretrievably lost, and suffering is introduced to humankind. In the Iroquoian creation story, perfection rests not in the absence of evil, but in its balance with good. As embodied in the right-handed and left-handed twins, these two forces exist side by side in the world on the turtle's back. The twins' acts of creation are complementary, and the world grows because of their rivalry with each other. To the Iroquois, relations with others, whether kin or outsiders, were likewise a perpetual give and take aimed at sustaining peace and prosperity. Iroquois family and community. That balancing act began within the most immediate human relationships in Iroquois communities, and then fanned outward. At the start of the colonial era, the Iroquois inhabited a string of about 10 towns and numerous smaller hamlets along an east-to-west axis from the Hudson River to the Genesee Valley. Populations within these communities ranged widely, from 100 to 200 for the hamlets to 1,000 to 2,000 for the larger towns, which were typically built on hilltops and surrounded by palisades of wooden posts sunk vertically into the ground. Not surprisingly, Europeans took to calling these impressively fortified Iroquois towns castles. Within the palisades, the Iroquois lived in longhouses, long rectangular structures made from saplings and tree bark that housed several related families. An average longhouse was about 100 feet in length and 20 feet in width, with a central aisle dotted by four or five hearths, each one serving the heating and cooking needs of two families who made their lodgings on opposite sides of the aisle. The physical closeness of individuals living within a longhouse encouraged the communal pursuit of such tasks as cooking and child-rearing, and it also placed a premium on conflict avoidance and consensus-building in social interactions. This communal ethic extended to the world outside the longhouse. Men and women cooperated in their different types of work, the men in hunting and fishing, the women in planting and tending the fields beyond the palisades. Related families also traveled and worked together in annual commutes to fishing and hunting camps, where they took advantage of seasonal bounties in natural resources. Our modern tendency is to think of Indians as identifying themselves according to membership in a tribe. But this problematic term did not gain currency until the 19th century, and even then, it was used more often by non-Indians than by Indians themselves. Colonial observers recognized Indians as belonging to nations, groups of people who shared the same language, cultural practices, and territory. This designation made sense when the Iroquois dealt with outsiders, but in their day-to-day affairs, more immediate ties of kinship shaped their identity and interaction with others. Like many other Native Americans in eastern North America, the Iroquois organized themselves into extended families and clans. The families that shared a longhouse were related to one another through a common maternal ancestor. Their lineage was part of a larger clan, whose membership was also determined matrilineally. Children deriving their affiliation from their mother rather than their father. Iroquois clans had animal totems, the bear, wolf, and turtle being the most common, and the image of this totem, worn as jewelry, carved or painted on a longhouse, or drawn with quill and ink on a treaty document, announced a person's or group's clan affiliation. Clans played such a powerful role in Iroquois identity that an incest taboo existed against marrying within your clan, even if the potential mate was from another community. Regardless of biological or physical distance, another clan member was still a brother or sister. Within and between their communities, the Iroquois divided their clans into moieties, complementary opposites that owed reciprocal social and ceremonial obligations to each other. This was another common practice among Eastern Indians, who used it to create webs of social interdependence between people that extended well beyond their immediate families. The Iroquois practiced their most important forms of government at the local level. Each community was autonomous, relying on councils made up of clan elders, some of whom held their position by virtue of hereditary status, others by virtue of accomplishment and reputation, to make decisions and settle disputes that concerned the whole. A 17th-century French captive among the Oneidas described how such councils worked. "He, then, or she, who has some propositions to make, begins by assembling the elders of his or her family, meaning clan, and if it is something that concerns the warriors, one or two captains of this same family are summoned to be witnesses to the thing being proposed. Each one there gives his opinion in a very serious manner, after which they agree upon the procedure. That being finished, an elder appointed by them goes to invite the other families. I mean the elders and war chiefs, supposing that the thing requires it. In this way, all these formalities are done in a very similar manner. If in the decision they judge it appropriate to give notice of it to the other villages, they appoint one or two of the principal men of each family to go and explain their plans to their allies." As this description indicates, lineage played a central role in group decision-making, and as this process spiraled outward, clan affiliations provided the means for communicating with and including others. Such deliberations were time-consuming, but also remarkably effective at creating consensus without resort to coercion. Iroquois notions of reciprocity also shaped their relations with outsiders. From an Iroquoian perspective, the outside world could be divided into two groups: those with whom you traded, and those with whom you warred. Or, as an Iroquois speaker put it at an Albany Treaty Council in 1735, "Trade and peace we take to be one thing." Before the arrival of Europeans, the Iroquois traded and warred with other native peoples in eastern North America. Archaeological evidence indicates that the Iroquois acquired a variety of objects and materials from long-distance trading partners, including marine shell beads from coastal New England, soft copper from the upper Great Lakes, and pipestone from the upper Mississippi Valley. However, there is not any corresponding evidence for large-scale trade in what might be called the necessities of life: food, clothing, tools, or weapons. Before contact with Europeans, the Iroquois supplied these material wants through their own labor and local resources. The small quantities of the shell beads, copper, pipestone, and other non-indigenous goods found at Iroquois sites suggest that such items were probably acquired as diplomatic presents exchanged with outsiders. Gifts given in diplomatic encounters established mutual obligations between the giver and recipient, in much the same way that the clan and moiety system created those bonds within a nation. Harman Meindert's Van den Bochard, a Dutch trader who visited Iroquois in 1634 through 35 to counter competition from the French, learned this lesson quickly when a Mohawk chief came to ask me what we were doing in his country and what we brought him for gifts. The Dutchman replied that we brought him nothing, but that we just came for a visit. The chief called the Dutch scoundrels, worth nothing because we brought him no gifts, and praised the French who had traded with them here with six men and had given them good gifts. Diplomacy with outsiders, then, was an extension of the same principles that governed social relations within Iroquois families and communities. Each side engaged in councils with the other to maintain peace between them. Such negotiations brought tangible benefits to both sides, such as safe passage through the homelands of a neighboring people or alliance against a common enemy. Reciprocal acts of gift exchange in these diplomatic encounters, although they involved only small quantities of goods, were nevertheless central to their success, for the objects involved gave tangible form to the emotions and relationships expressed in the negotiations. Friendship, esteem, alliance. Just as the maintenance of healthy social relations within an Iroquois community required constant attention to communal obligations, so too did keeping the peace with outsiders depend on regular participation in diplomacy and gift exchanges. The roots of diplomacy. The Iroquois League. When referring to themselves collectively, the peoples who formed the Iroquois League called themselves the Haudenosaunee, the people of the Longhouse. That name reflected the geographic dimensions of their homelands, stretching in a long rectangular corridor south of Lake Ontario. The Onondagas were known as the Firekeepers of the League because of their location at the geographic center of Iroquois. The Senecas were known as the Keepers of the Western Door, and the Mohawks as the Keepers of the Eastern Door. Just as life within an Iroquois longhouse required cooperation among families who shared resources, labor, and living space, so too did keeping the peace within the Iroquois League require maintaining a delicate balance between individual autonomy and communal obligation. The League commanded no temporal institutions or resources to achieve its ends, no armies, courts, or taxes. To make it work, the Iroquois applied the same tools that they used to cultivate peace and prosperity within their communities. Lineages and clans were the sinews that tied people together. Moieties allowed for the proper observation of rituals that preserved peace and well-being, and the exchange of sacred objects.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.